right, so it's 11 o'clock. Hey, thanks for showing up. So what we're going to be talking about today is, obviously, we're at AMD, Automotive Aftermarket Sheet Metal. Before we get started, I just want to say a few thank yous. I know everybody in here is going to join me in saying, holy cow, what a great event. Triple crown of hot rodding, right? Did this thing happen or not? Yeah. Absolutely. The industry that showed up for this event is fantastic, and my buddy Tim announced this morning that this is a three-year run. This is the first of three contracted shows. Put this on your calendar for next year, 100%, because it's only going to get better from here. So I want to personally thank AMD Auto Metal Direct. I'm working with them on a couple of different levels, some educational, foundational stuff, which is super important to everybody here. And quite frankly, they're just nice people. So thanks for Triple Crown of Hot Rodding, and thank you for AMD. And one of the greatest things about this event is that everybody's here, right? So when everybody's here, why not get these guys together? Let's have some fun talks, right? So we're going to do a brief introduction to people that need no introduction. Chip Foose, world-renowned designer, TV guy. Jesse Greening, two Riddler Awards, right? Greening Auto Company. Dave Kindig. Right?
Zero Riddler Awards.
But, you know, industry icon, he wins the Hair Altitude Award for the day. And congratulations on the C1 stuff, man. Really nice. So, and Steve Mank, I am personally convinced that Steve Mank, there's 6 degrees of separation from the entire automotive aftermarket industry to Steve Mank. We know him as RoboCop, the Batman car builder. He was a co-host on my compadre in the Power Block days for the Muscle Car Show. So how about a nice round of applause for these guys for showing up? So I just want to say one more thing without blowing any smoke. The one common thread that all of us have here, and I like to include myself in that, is that everybody here is on a high level of excellence, and the common thread here in this table is integrity. These guys are good people. They're super nice guys, and I'm proud to call them all friends, and so it's a really cool thing to have you guys here. So let's get started. Telescope, exactly. So I got my start in collision repair, and everybody remembers when J.C. Whitney was the only place you could get, you being a bug guy, J.C. Whitney catalog, you could build an entire Volkswagen bug, and this is many years ago. The automotive aftermarket, especially when it comes to sheet metal, has really come up in the game to the point where we have, I was recently touring the R&D facility at AMD, and they're reverse engineering a dozen vehicles, I'm not kidding, and doing it properly with American hands on the parts, and really doing a nice job of it. So the game has come up an awful lot. So my first question for you guys, and the way we'll do this, just like a show of hands, I'm not going to direct questions to you guys personally. If you feel like answering one of these questions, and they're all softballs, just raise your hand, and if we have an opinion, we don't know where this goes, so we'll figure it out. But we're going to be here again for about 45 minutes, and then we'll open it up to a little bit of Q&A for you guys if you want to stick around. So, what is the percentage of aftermarket panels versus original panels when you guys are building a car? And go.
Who's starting?
Yeah, I guess Chip. Yeah,
that'd be easier.
Yeah. Looks like Bob Barker with that thing.
Come on down.
Well, for me, what I try to convey to my customers is let's find the best car we can find.
Yeah.
Because you want to get the best, all parts, not just sheet metal, but everything on the car. But if you don't have necessarily great parts on it, then you want to find the best sheet metal you can.
Yeah.
And, I've had both. I've had junk panels, but if the original panel is worse than the other panel, a reproduction panel, but you can cut and alter that reproduction panel and make it work, what we're trying to do is create the nicest quality car that we can.
Yeah.
So you do it with whatever you've got.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So unless... Let's face it, these cars that we're working on are 40, 50, 60, 70 years old.
We all want to reach for the original panel if it's just like it was made. That doesn't exist anymore. So as far as, we've all seen each other cut up sheet metal and all that kind of stuff. So for me, it's a real blessing to have aftermarket stuff that we're not afraid to cut up. If we want to dice a Shelby fender or something like that, we can reach for AMD or an aftermarket and guilt-free. Now we can carve them up and do custom stuff, right?
Yeah, and the aftermarket panel may not necessarily be the entire panel that you put on the car. You cut the section out that's bad on the car and replace it with the aftermarket panel there.
Yeah.
But I try to keep the most of the original car that we can.
Yeah. What's your philosophy?
Go ahead, Jesse. You have an opinion?
So if you've ever watched my TV show, you know I have a really hard time picking a good car. Ask Kevin. And so I actually really quite enjoy our partnership and our friendship with AMD because I need them. I pick really, really bad cars to start with. Kevin Hart's 70 Challenger out there, a perfect example. I bought a car that's an original RT. We wanted the RT, even though we weren't really keeping anything numbers matching. I literally, when I got the car, I kept the door jams. I found a better set of doors, originals, out of California. Kept the roof structure and the cowl panel. Everything else is either AMD or hand-rolled. So that car is basically from ground up, pretty much everything but the structure had to be purchased and moved around and modified to make that car as nice as it is. So, yeah, it's nice to have parts. You know, a lot of times in the past, you know, before AMD really was known to me anyway, there was parts out there, and it seems like most of the stuff, I was always just looking for a cowl hood on something at the beginning. I mean, 24 years ago, that was the thing. Cowl hoods and flames, right? So now, with the amount of stuff that AMD especially has had on the market, the fit and finish, I think, is quite a bit better than anything I started with 24 years ago. And so it's really nice the amount of work that they are going to go through to make sure that all of the products that they're still adding to their line are actually proper fit. So I think that's really important.
When I started doing this 40-some-odd years ago, I'm the old man of the group. I was up in northern Ohio, so I had a lot of cars from Michigan, Ohio, Pennsylvania, and finding stuff there was just crazy.
When you started, it was leather
panels. When I was, yeah, it was and wood. But but I just I've always seen that we've used even just buy a whole panel because that was available. That's what is available. That's what's around. Is it more times for you guys than not that you use a piece of that panel rather than the whole panel? That's what we did, because up there, you either had a choice of trying to spend so much time in the beginning of the project repairing old dead metal and trying to make stuff, or get a really, really nice piece off of something you're not intending on using the whole panel for, but man, are you glad it's there when you need it. It's just up north. Let me find out in regions, or maybe Jason can tell us, what regions of the country they sell more metal? Is it up in the Northeast and also even up where you, it snows like crazy.
Yep. Well, and especially when I buy the cars for my clients, they sell a lot of metal out in my area. We certainly, Salt Lake doesn't necessarily put salt down like they used to. They actually do a brine solution, which I think is pretty common across the board now, which is great. If you go to Idaho, gravel. Right? Has everybody ever been up there and replaced your windshield going to the Boise Roadster Show? So I've done it every single time I've taken a one-ton dually up there, new windshield, after I go to Idaho. But as far as the salt goes, I mean, the closer I think that you get to an ocean, certainly down where it's super humid. Obviously, this is quite a bit more humid than Salt Lake for me. I'm starting to grill gills because I've been here over 3 days. So, but, I think you're always going to find the cars that haven't been necessarily stored for a long time indoors and kept in great condition. But that's that's what we get to work with. We get to find those little charms in a barn somewhere and pull them out and revamp them and make them somebody's dream car. And it's great to just have great products to be able to choose from.
I don't want to leave Jesse Greening out. So I have another question. Actually, it's about aftermarket panels. So my background is collision repair. The e-coating, it's electrodeposition primer, e-coat. It's the black primer on panels. So I've talked to a lot of different builders over the years. A lot of guys, because of past experience with e-coat, job one is to strip it down to metal. Get rid of the e-coat and then get to the metal. Jesse, what's your philosophy on that at Greening?
We'll strip most of it down. You know, the G coat's good there in places you can't get, or where you're putting it. Or the inside of a door or something like that. So, but generally we'll take it down, especially if we're because the whole car, we like to see it all in bare metal, and yeah. We're fitting gaps at times too, so we're getting into it a little bit at times. Yeah. At times we are. So
in collision, they don't want you to do that at all, because that's a layer of protection, right?
Yeah. But we're actually, you know, we're coming back on that bare metal with prep. We're using all Glazurit products, and they have a really good bare metal etch primer that we put on it, and that's our base to do any prep work or, you know, getting it ready for paint.
Bit of trivia. Does anybody remember what in 1965 Ford's warranty was on a new car?
I'm old enough.
Do you remember? Yeah, now today we got a 336. My wife's got a Hyundai. It's got a 7-year whatever, 100,000.
1 year.
1 year. So think about that. These cars that are our automotive icons, they are literally characters and these moments and places in time in our lives. It's like baseball, field of dreams. For me, it's cars are my field of dreams. That's my markers in time, and I'm sure you guys share some of that as well. These cars were never intended to last any longer than about 5 years, right? 1 year, and Ford's going, see ya, you're on your own. In 1982, Dodge came up, they had the K car, and they had to bribe people into buying them, so they put a 5-year warranty out in 1982, just to talk people into buying these things. So that's just an interesting thing. We forget about that. We forget about that in the industry, that there's a limited shelf life to these original parts. They were never intended. The factory corrosion resistance on the insides of these cars, when we pull them apart, I mean, they're dying from the inside out. And, you know, let's face it, we don't own cars. You guys don't own cars. We are the stewards of these vehicles that we pass on to the next generation. So we want to do the best we can.
I've got a question from back here.
Oh, I'm sorry. No, I'm sorry. All right. So,
I just want to say how impressed Mank's memory is. As you get older, I couldn't believe that he was able to answer that question. And he was first, did you see? It was amazing. So I wanted to say congratulations. And Dave's right behind you, 62.
All right, give the Kev dog a hand. So just a kind of a overview question. What are the changes that you guys have seen? Let's talk about aftermarket in general. The aftermarket, in my mind, has really stepped up over the past years. Saying let's take a 10-year snapshot. What have you guys seen? What's the most impressive and important change that the automotive aftermarket has kind of manifested in front of us over these last 10 years?
Well, first of all, the replacement panels that you got at the dealership were the reject panels from the assembly line.
Yes, 100%.
So you had to fix those as well as when you put them on the car in the auto body repair. Because that's where I grew up as well, in my dad's shop.
100%, yeah.
But the quality of the aftermarket products has gotten so much better. And we have to thank the computer for that.
Yeah.
Because we've got digital information. It's so much easier to recreate the panels that we're pulling off.
Right, absolutely, yeah.
Anybody want to add?
Yeah, I was just, I'll reinforce that, but it's just the availability of stuff now, like AMD offering such a wide line of products and parts and pieces, and it makes it so much easier for us nowadays. So you can get into these weird CUDAs that are a rare Ford that they didn't make very many of, and these guys are actually making some new parts for them, so we don't have to build that from scratch, so it's a pretty nice deal. So
I totally agree with everything you guys said. I think that the direction that they're going right now, I'm hoping that one day you guys actually run out of parts to create, and then maybe some of us guys that are passionate about putting stuff together could actually get together with some maybe aftermarket custom stuff that would be available from AMD, which would be really cool. Lower spoilers for Camaros, which are so popular. Just some different parts that would be something that maybe somebody would inspire to do that pays good tribute to the original cars. But, you know, eventually you guys are going to perfect everything. There's not going to be any other need for any tooling. So call me, call Chip, or Jesse. Maybe not him. It'll be a... Sorry, Steve.
I know, but no, it's... why I'm
here. He's our fall guy. I think that, definitely, I mean, the industry is certainly strong, and obviously the styles of cars and the builds that a lot of us shops are building now aren't so many street rods anymore. It's a lot more of the muscle cars, which is really where you guys really shined. at AMD. So, you know, I think that, exactly. I think that being able to, you guys are at the market before the market all gets there all and really starts to push, because we obviously have seen a big change in what the cars are out on the field and in the shows. And being able to support everybody that's not a street rodder, I mean, you guys have got it all kind of set out and ready to go. So, good job.
Jason, you need to put me on the payroll, because I'm now you guys. So, yeah, and I want
to. The only thing I'll add to that, Kevin, is that
to prove that the advancement of sheet metal is getting stronger all the time, and it's going to continue. Me, or 10 years ago, would you believe that you could buy a complete brand new sheet metal shell for a 57, for a Camaro, a whole car? So is it going to progress? Oh, yeah, like crazy.
So the other cool thing that I see happening is manufacturers, like you said, we're not going to talk about names. It doesn't matter about names. But there's companies taking the initiative to do bucks and assembly lines, maybe some offshore manufacturing, but they're putting them together here within the continental United States with guys that are doing it, that understand what panel gaps are, that understand what a closed door should feel like. So that's giving everybody here a huge advantage over, you know, some guys that cut their teeth in actually hacking apart original cars. It's a huge advantage. So I'm hoping that over the horizon, you guys will be doing this all. Yeah, uh-huh, maybe there's a scoop here. Maybe AMD is going to do some stuff over the horizon to where you guys have complete shells and assemblies, right? Wouldn't that be cool? And how much easier does it make our job, right? You know, and I don't consider myself a car builder like you guys. I'm a parts putter on her. I'm not an engine builder. I'm an LS Lego blocks kind of an engine builder, but I've got friends and no friends. So, but you know, my big thing, my cornerstone is paint and body. So everybody shares a little bit of that, and all you guys have dirt under your fingernails as well. So I want to bring up the car behind me. A buddy of mine is building this car. There's 3,000 labor hours in this car, Bay One Customs. It's in epoxy and rough metal fit. 3,000 labor hours. It's not an engine swap. It's a body swap Challenger. It's a Hellcat that has no idea that it looks like a 69 Charger. So from this point, now on this car, the hard work starts, in my opinion. So with that in mind, I just, you know, if everybody could just kind of put their 2 cents in, from the point where you get everything roughed out, gapped, you have a plan. Of course, everybody starts with a rendering and a plan. What's your just to give everybody a perspective, your time investment from this point forward, what are you going to put in for, let's say, labor hours resource to get this thing to the next level, to ready for, not even paint, ready for paint?
That all depends on the level you want to take the car to. You know, is it just the top surfaces you want nice? Or do you want the jams absolutely perfect? Do you want the floor absolutely perfect? Do you want to gap absolutely everything? Are you going to take it to compete for a Riddler type award? Or are you just building a driver? That's what has to be decided before you take it to the next level.
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, I totally agree with that, Chip, on all of it. But yeah, you've got to figure out the vision of the project, where it's going to go, and then you can plan accordingly through the build on it. So
I'm 8 years backlog, so I'm not going to answer the question. It's just more stress, man. I'm telling you. I think Chip's got it right on the head. You know, depending on the level of the car, if it's going to be a really nice driver, you know, you maybe just do a rocker shoots underneath the car, maybe not put a lot of time in, you know, blocking out and body and perfect polish underneath the car. Chassis, if it's been incorporated into a chassis, built back into a unibody, I mean, obviously you got a lot of finish work there to make it nice, or belly pans, and maybe that's the way you go. So it really just depends on what the design, the build level is. At this point right now, if we were just building something maybe to the quality of what the Camaro is over there, you'd probably be sitting probably 2,500 to 3,200 hours to do body, paint, polish, and start the reassembly, which is typically on a car like that with computer systems and everything else, modern drivetrain, I'm assuming, because I didn't really get a good look at the car as I walked over here, but assuming that, you're probably in about the 700-hour range between upholstery and wiring, getting the car running, putting it on the dyno, and just checking it out. And then you got to come up with a whole bunch of other excuses, which takes 2 weeks for me to actually get the nerve to call the customer and tell them I'm going to keep the car for another 6 months so I can drive it and make sure it doesn't break down on them. And my neighbors think I'm the biggest drug dealer you've ever seen in your life. So what does that kid do with all these cars? So anyway, no, it's, you know, I guess it really just depends on the quality of the build, you know, and then there's other aspects of the build as well. I mean, you know, if you're going nuts, most every one of our cars, we deburr all of the blocks, the transmission, suspension. We take all of the casting flaws out of everything, and then we bring it up in paint just to give it a nice appearance. You know, even my production cars, those we'll spend 3-4 days just on the motor and transmission and the accessories, grinding and polishing down the aluminum, getting it prepped so that it has a nice finish to the paint. So it just adds to the rest of the quality of the car.
And you guys didn't leave me much to say, but there's one thing we all know is you guys out there that are builders, all of us that are builders, even though that car looks pretty complete and the shell looks really good and it's sitting on its own shoes, you know that car has to be taken back apart and built at least 2 to 3 more times back to that with everything that gets done that you guys all mentioned there over and over and over. It's not together. It'll come apart 2 or 3 more times. Minimum.
Yep. And I think Kevin's over there calling his therapist after I kind of brought up the the amount of stress and work that is. But it is a lot of fun and it's very rewarding. You know, really, honestly, at the end of the day, I don't really have a job. This is just more of like something I just really enjoy. I get to work with great people that I'm building the cars with, the people I work with. And, you know, we go to work every day and get to build somebody's dream car. It's not a bad gig. So, yeah, it's just very, very fun.
So everybody has a consensus that we're not talking about hundreds of labor hours. We're talking about thousands of labor hours to bring a car to the caliber that it deserves. And certainly cars on the show field are showing that 100%. So, and the other answer, which was very clear, is, you know, how much is it going to cost? And the answer is yes. So I'll never forget this conversation with you when you came to the TV studio, one of the many times you came to the Power Block studios. You were hanging out with us in the truck studio and just having this great conversation. And you, I'll never forget this quote. This is a Chip Foose original quote. You said, "We're only as good as our customers allow us to be." And that's really the truth. And you elaborated on that. And it comes down to a relationship. And, of course, everything is a transactional relationship, whether it's financial, friendship, or whatever. But it's all based on relationship. So when you build that with a customer, you know, that really resonated with me. And, you know, because we're all part of social media these days. There's a lot of Facebook groups talking about, you know, job costing this. What does it cost for a paint job? What would you do to repair this? And I'm part of these forums because I like to try and do tech support whenever I can. But, you know, it's the answer to how much does it cost to paint your car is how is exactly what these guys said. So thank you for that grossly ambiguous answer. But it's the God's honest truth, right?
Well, I've always said that I'm extremely lucky and blessed to make a living doing something that's 100% unnecessary. You know, the world doesn't need another hot rod or muscle car. But the greatest thing about my career is that it's 100% passion driven, that these customers will reach into their wallet and pay us to build their dream cars. That's not a job.
That's awesome.
You know, it's, yeah. I just, like I say, I feel lucky and blessed that I get to do what I do for a living. Anyone want to add?
Yeah. Thanks, Chip. I've always said kind of the same thing. I specialize in selling stuff you don't need that's very expensive. And I get to show up every day to build somebody's dream. And, yeah, we certainly don't.
Hey, I'm Kevin Tetz, and I'm so proud to announce that I'm working with AMD. I'm very excited about it. We've been working on this plan for a while, and it's finally coming together. If you know me, you know that my wheelhouse is paint and body and restoration. So what we're going to be doing is bringing a lot of those disciplines and techniques right to you with how-to videos, technical information, still frame articles from magazines, things like how to replace your hood without scratching the paint on the fenders. We're bringing that all to you as well. And if you know me, you know that I've been doing automotive television for a long time. So with that, I've been able to meet a lot of my heroes. And we're going to bring some of those people in, names that you recognize, and kind of see how they tick. See how they make million-dollar cars. And it's super fascinating to see how somebody like that operates on a really high level. We're going to be talking with lots of people that you're going to find fascinating. We're also going to bring you a lot of videos showing the fundamentals of metal replacement and all the other things that go along with the restoration. Another great thing that we're going to be doing is answering your questions. You guys get to ask us the questions, and we're going to, whether it's guys in the R&D or whether people outside of the industry, we're going to get you the technical information that you're looking for to help you with your restoration projects, whether it's a B-body Mopar or, in my case, an OBS truck and things like that. We're very much looking forward to bringing you that information. So keep on watching. Watch for us on the socials. I'm going to be working with Eddie, the guys in the R&D department, and at my place in Tennessee, and we're going to bring you the best of what we can bring you. So thank you, and looking forward to seeing you guys at some of the many car shows that we're also going to be doing out in the industry. So we'll see you real soon.
We have a perfect example of that, and that would be my dad's old 59 Chevrolet truck, fleet side truck. If you know anything about Greening Auto Company or anything, you probably see that red truck running around and a bunch of people hanging around the back of it drinking some beers. But that's been in the family over 50 years. It's never going anywhere. And thanks to these guys, I'm actually going to do a few repairs on it over the winter. So some sheet metal pieces that up in the cowl area that you previously couldn't get. I would have had to go make it. So now they got them, and we're going to use them. So
I've got a fuzzy memory of at a car show with you guys, riding around with you and Jeff in the back of that truck, looking around at the show field, and there may or may not have been a bottle of Jägermeister in amongst the ice. And like I said, it's a fuzzy memory, but it's a memory. So I know these guys will pay attention to this because this is something that's super important in our industry. Real quick, not to make this about me, but I've pushed away everything in my career to focus on creating trade school courses for this next generation of people coming up into this industry that has been so good to me and so good to these guys. So I'm full force into that, and it's near and dear to my heart. Everybody that I know that has a hot rod shop is wringing their hands, dying for talent. They're dying for skills, dying for people that are passionate about what they're doing. So I want to ask you guys a question. Raise your hands if you are in a shop. Are you working in a shop? Who's a builder? Who's a fabricator? Loss. We got about half the people here. How many people own shops? Who owns a hot rod shop or a mechanic shop? So what are we going to do? What are we going to do to inspire this next generation of students, of people coming into our industry, when maybe all they're told from the outside in is that it's just a job? So that's my question to you guys.
I'm gonna tell them to go to dental school and make some real money.
Not the right answer. Chip. Thanks, Chip. Thanks for Chip. He's gonna leave now. So my question is, and you can answer this again if you want to, what's your best advice to somebody new coming up into the industry that thinks there might be, obviously you can't fast track. You're not going to come out of technical school and knock on Dave's door and get a job on the top shelf build. I love what you're doing with your educational stuff, so kudos for you for doing that stuff. But please, please answer that question. What would you say to somebody coming up in the industry on what would inspire them into fulfilling their goal in this career?
Pay attention to the details. You know, their quality is what's going to carry them through to getting better and better customers. Yeah. So you have to, and don't do it for the money. Do it for the passion.
Yeah.
You know, you're not going to get paid for every hour that you work in the beginning.
Yeah.
So you have to prove yourself.
Yeah.
And just like that quote, is you're only as good as your customer allows you to be? Well, you're not going to get the best customers when you're just starting. Not right off the so you have to prove yourself to get those customers.
Yeah. I can't add anything. I was gonna say
Jesse's already got everything figured out in business. I'm so jealous of him.
Chip said it for me.
Well, yeah, I mean, really, kind of on the same line as what Chip was saying. Finding talent has been much more difficult, certainly in the last 3 years. I think a big turn in 2020, whatever that was, that passed really close to outer space and dragged all of the hardworking upcoming kids and people into this industry. There is still those people out there. If you'd asked me 5 years ago, would you hire somebody as an apprentice? I would have been like, man, I really don't have the time to teach them. They really need to go get at least 5 years experience, play with some cars, take lots of pictures. That's something I always really tell people. You want to get in the industry, you want to work for somebody, go figure out how to do the stuff. There's lots of YouTube stuff. There's plenty of great shops out there that do have apprentice opportunities. Paint, education. Yep. Yep. So I'm hooked on phonics. So, but trying to get more people has been really a big struggle for us, certainly in the last 3 years. And working with Lincoln Technical Institute and creating the Kindig Academy in Denver, Colorado, we have 10,000 square feet, and that's still a challenge, to be honest with you. Finding talent from there was what my hope has been. I know that I've inspired a lot of people that have been through the classes. We've had 6-week classes, 1-week classes, and 3-day classes. We're still building up where we want to be with that program, but I'm really hoping that a lot more people will go through that program, find that passion, and get good at it. Certainly, there's a lot of guys that like to specialize in one aspect, whether it's sheet metal, electronics, upholstery, body and paint. My thing I would tell anybody that's wanting to get into the industry and get really good at what you're doing is don't just take on one aspect. Figure out who you're getting the car from in the chain, who you're giving it to, so that you understand what you should be receiving and what you should be sending down to the next guys, and then working together. But more importantly, open your wingspan a little bit. If you're a metal guy and you're banging on metal all the time and pal hammers and English wheels and bead rollers and shrinker stretchers, take a minute and go body work that and understand what it is that you're giving to the next guy that's in the chain so that you can give them a better product. And maybe, if you're slow in the metal shop, you can go over and help out in the body shop. And if it's something that maybe you might find a passion to. I kind of just grew up learning from other people in the Volkswagen industry, because those guys would let me watch them do what they're doing, and well, they're only spending $20 to fix the entire car, right? So I got really proficient at Volkswagens, because that's all I could afford to drive, and I figured out how to fix them. You blow a spark plug out of the cylinder head, and you need a helicoil. Well, if you don't have the $75 to pay the Volkswagen shop to do it, you get your work boot off, you shove the spark plug back in there and shove the boot between the side firewall and that spark plug, and it holds it for 3 months until you have the $79 to get it fixed. I know this from fact. So
we've all done great stuff.
I burnt my shoe, man, but it worked. It was awesome. So, dream big. If you land just below it, it's not so bad. And honestly, this is a great industry to be in. It really is. And you were certainly right, too, by saying that you shouldn't get into this industry for the money. If you learn what you're doing and you're doing it very well, that's a byproduct of doing what you love to do and that you've done very well. So, like with my clients, long after we're done talking about the uncomfortable part of the money, I didn't get into business for the money. I got into it for the art and for building the relationship, building the cars, and being able to do that over and over again multiple times. I always figured if you're doing a good job, the money will be there. And that has worked out in 24 years. So, but it is not easy. There is much easier. I'd love to just dental school. Pet grooming. That's a great one. Just specialize in miniature schnauzers. I am looking for a new person to do a haircut on my miniature schnauzer. So contact me after. But anyway, thank you.
Please. I just want to tag a little bit on to the end of what you guys are saying. Chip was saying that the people that own these projects that we're lucky enough to get to work on, everything with them about their cars, about their vehicles, is passion. They're looking for guys like all of us. I know you guys have got to be the same. They want to see the passion in us that they have about their car. That's where you'll get to work. That's where it continually comes from. And if you have the passion, it'll come to you. But there's so many avenues in our industry that you can go down. It's limitless. You just make yourself available. The money may not be the greatest at one point. The hours may not be the greatest at one point, especially if you travel and do all the things that we do. But if you make yourself available to learn, to do whatever needs to be done, it will find you. Because when our industry and people in our industry find that passion in you, it's available. We always need more people. We always need more guys and girls. I mean, it's huge. And it's got like, it was a hobby, then it became a business. Now it's a huge industry, and it's just amazing what you can do. I always tell people one thing, especially the younger guys that we started this conversation with.
Is that me?
That's the day. Well, Dave or Jesse. If you get what I'm about to say, you got it made. If you don't understand it, you never will. Whatever it takes has one definition. Period. And if you get that and you are willing to do that, you can go the limit. It will not matter. It will find you.
Yeah, and just one more thing too. You know, old school, I mean, you've certainly been building cars your entire life, and Jesse, obviously, everybody's kind of grown up in that industry. We kind of have it in our blood. I don't remember what the hell I was going to say.
What?
It's that age thing.
Wow.
They kept me out.
Really?
You guys kept me out really late last night. What was I going to? I lost my train of thought, but I will get it back. I cannot remember what I was just about to say. It was poignant. Oh, no, I remember what it was. So whether you're doing upholstery, paint, body, you know, sheet metal, all that kind of stuff, the industry has changed certainly in the last 24 years that I've been in business. The amount of technology now that's come into our industry, 3D scanning, 3D printing, CNC machines. If you had told me 5-10 years ago I would have three programmers that don't actually go out and work on sheet metal parts anymore, they know cars, but they are literally just programming parts for special projects we're doing, for production vehicles, trying to keep track of now an inventory for 5 cars of my CF1s at all times on the shelf. I mean, there's so many things that have changed in the last 24 years and certainly in the last 10 years from my shop that, again, it's kind of crazy to think back. I borrowed a hammer when I started my business. I didn't have my own hammer for sheet metal. I had a small wooden bench that I made. It looked like a park bench seating, but I'd flip it over. I had reverse curves and this really hard wood that had just been beat up forever and ever that I built, restored my first house with. Those were my main two tools. And just figuring it out. You know, I didn't grow up with anybody building something in the garage, so I had to watch other people and just figure it out on my Volkswagen. And if you screwed up, at the time it was 50 cents for a newspaper. That's back when they had print instead of phones. It's a newspaper. I'll tell you more about it later. You guys really need to talk to your kids and tell them how hard it was. But it was $50 for another car and start over. So.
I'll add one thing is I can tell you that every hot rod owner out there, hot rod shop owner that is successful, every one of them has pride in their work. And they'll do whatever it takes to make it right. And that's what it does take.
So kind of on that same theme, we talked about money, just like in television. I think Jesse Greening's the only guy up here that hasn't hosted a television show, but you've been on a ton of them. So, you know, spoiler alert, you don't make a lot of money in cable TV. You just don't. So people have this misconception that you're going to be on a TV show. I've been on TV shows for 20 years, and, you know, it really is. It's a great job to have, but it's not the money that people think it is. So there has to be some other driver for that. Is it ego? No. It's not ego. It's the ability to pass on a message. But I want to follow up with the whole integrity thing, because it's really important. You know, I started off with this statement and pontification blathering about money. If you lead a path of integrity, and this is universal in life, and I know you guys will echo this, if you lead a path of integrity, especially in your work habits and your work ethic that you bring to work every day, the money falls in. The money will backfeed your passion. So passion is a huge word with a capital P. But so
if you're disillusioned with this and you think, well, no, I'm not going to make any money, or, you know, entry level Porter pay and collision repair is 40 grand, I can't live on that. Well, guess what? 2 years later, if you're diligent, if your passion feeds, you're going to backfeed that, and there's a really good possibility you could be making six figures as a metal tech in a collision repair shop in a very short amount of time. Malcolm Gladwell says we need 10,000 hours of dedicated practice to become expert and proficient in one thing. Well, guess what? You know, a little bit of passion goes a long way towards that. So exactly what you guys are saying, I'm glad we all had the same answer and we have the same philosophy on that. So my if I can be so bold and egotistical to give advice, is to find your passion, find what you're passionate for, and don't worry about money. I know that's hard to say, but the money will always find your passion and it will backfeed your dedication, but it takes a while. The other F word, I saw you coming across, and I said, it says one off on Jesse's shirt. I thought it said something completely different. I thought he just came from a Black Flag concert and it said something else. So I'm so glad it says one off. Anyway, not to go down that road, but I've got Kindig disease. I forgot what I was going to say. Okay. My last thing to say is, do not be afraid to fail. If I can say anything that's inspirational to anybody, the value of failure in my life, I have screwed more stuff up. I am the captain. I am the team captain and the spokesperson of failure. Do not be afraid of falling flat on your face, because that's where our best and steepest growth curve is, right?
There's no such thing as failure.
Oh, thank you.
You've succeeded at finding what doesn't work.
Wow. Mic drop, we're done. So I want to give you guys one more chance to just talk about stuff. We've talked about sheet metal, of course. We're here with AMD, great company. I love being associated with them. We've talked about some secrets that we have. If you can just give a little bit of experience. Everybody loves looking inward vicariously at businesses that are on, you know, social media, at the big awards shows, television stuff. Pass something on to people that have spent their time at a car show here listening to us talk about ourselves. What's something cool that's coming up for Foose?
I've got a project coming that I've always wanted to do for probably the last 25 years. I've got a customer that has bought a Duesenberg. And when you bought a Duesenberg in the 30s, you bought a chassis. And that went to a coach builder, and you designed and built your body on top of it. It came with fenders, it came with a grill and a hood. So Rob Hilardi's has bought a Duesenberg, and I'm gonna take that car, peel the body that's on it off, and we're gonna design and build our own body. So I'm very excited about that project.
So what was the question again?
What's coming up?
Well, I've actually dabbled outside of the car world a little bit, and I've got a actually what goes good with hot rods is beer, so we're doing a brewery, so along with it. Yeah, so everybody's got to come down to Northern Alabama and have a beer with us soon. So
there goes the hot rod shop.
Well, you guys talking about it being really passionate about everything. I said, hell, I'm pretty passionate about drinking a few beers, so I might as well make some.
Well, I'm actually going to stop showing up to the shop. I'm going to go out to Jesse's place and be a taste tester, so, because I do like a beer as well. You know, actually, this last couple of years, I've gotten very involved in the manufacturing of the CF1 Corvettes, and it's been very successful. I think it's really kind of helped my business, because my background before starting my shop 24 years ago was doing production for high performance coatings, HPC. And Jeff Holm showed me the world for 8.5 years. I'd never been on a plane. My wife had never been on a plane. And we got the first opportunity to go to the SEMA show in 93 or 94. And since then, I've just been meeting the most incredible people with the same love for cars that I have. And
I was a collision repair tech, and it's my foundation in skilled trades as a body guy.
gave me the foundation to have a career that I could never have dreamt of, being an author, being a freelance tech writer, and being in the same room as these guys. Now, I don't consider myself the caliber of builder because I'm a student of this industry, and I think we all are at the heart. But for me, what's coming down the horizon with me next, and this time next year, I hope to have a different conversation, but I'm headed straight to high school shop programs, colleges, trade schools, collision repair programs there. I've designed digital training that's companion training for the in-class curriculum. So again, I want to give back. I want to give back to this industry that's been so unbelievably great to me and given me, based off of my foundation and skilled trades, this wonderful career path that I couldn't have dreamt up. So so that's what's coming for Kevin and for Paintucation. And if it's okay with you guys, can we open it up to a couple of questions from these guys? So raise your hand. Has anybody got a question? All right, then. See ya. Come on, be brave. What's your name, sir? What question have you got of these rock stars?
I don't have any questions, but it's a good career to be in.
It is a good career to be in. How old are you?
15.
He's 15, so Dave, there's your next metal guy. Jeff? Yeah.
I started for real, like, that was the age I started.
15 years old, working in a shop. Yeah, I kind of grew up around it. I'm sure everybody else did, right? You know, of course, your dad, right? You know, and your dad. And so you're the...
No, my real dad split when I was 5 and just figured it out.
That's good. That's awesome, man. That's a story to tell as well. So, you know, in my... Does anybody have any other questions? Icons in the industry. Yes, sir. What year was this?
2007.
2007. So he
upcoming machine.
Yeah. I am CNC Chris.
Fantastic. Very good. So I've seen, I've no doubt everybody else is the same. I've seen this guy, and it makes me proud to know him. I've seen you stand there in an autograph line for hours and hours until the security guards are throwing you out, but you are not going to let anybody go that wants to say hi or say thanks. All of you guys are the same way. So, yeah, go ahead.
I've been lucky enough to go to ship a long time. I have worked his security lines, I've worked his lines at shows, just volunteering, helping out in Detroit. The big show in the country for indoor shows. Chip had a line that was insane. An hour after, it was like at 9 o'clock at night, he was supposed to be off. The show closed at 11. The show closed, they let the line stay. Chip stayed on stage. This has happened multiple times. Security finally came and told us we had to get out of the building because they secured the building. He walked through Cobo Hall, which is huge, so slow to get as many more kids and many more things, and these security guys were going nuts, but that's just the way he is. I mean.
So that is the way he is, and of course, we're all loving on Chip, but it's the truth, man, and it's what I talked about from the beginning, this thread of integrity and just nice guy-ness.
People are more important than the cars,
yeah.
And that's all we have to remember.
Yeah. This whole industry is built off of relationships. SEMA, has anybody been to SEMA? SEMA is a family reunion for people that go. It's a wonderful thing. You had a question.
I just wanted to say, like, for me personally, so, like, Chip's the main reason why I went to Logitech and did everything I did. I was just a Jewish kid. I was just some, like, random Jewish kid who loved this, fell in love with Overhaulin.
Are your student loans paid off yet?
The one thing...
That's a no.
It got wiped away last year.
You're kidding?
Yeah, it happened.
Wow.
It was pretty cool.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
Very good. So just like you guys, I'm such an admirer of you guys' skill. We're running out of time. I just want to say from the bottom of my heart, thank you. This came from a text message and a phone call to make, and it's such a cool thing to do. So thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you for taking the time out of your busy day and meeting us here and just shooting the breeze about what it is that we're so passionate about. Thank you, guys, and please thank these guys with me.
Thank you for coming out.